praise God. Amen.
Amen.
Can we just say a quick amen for that worship?
Yes.
I feel the Spirit of God in this place, and I got to confess tonight that I'm going to be preaching this message with a little bit of a heavy heart. So I just need you guys to come and agree with me right now.
Hallelujah.
I am so thankful to God that I'm even able to stand up here and preach this word. Because it is literally a miracle that I am standing up here tonight.
Amen.
I remember a time in my life where the last place that I would be on a Friday night is in Shiloh Baptist Church. You would have found me in Manaswan, but you would have found me at the Osprey.
Come on in.
Not up here. But I thank God for Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Because the whole entire time, he was standing at the right hand of the Father, pleading on my behalf.
Yes, he was.
Yes.
He was pleading, saying, Lord, give him one more day.
Hallelujah.
Give him one more chance.
Yes.
Because I got a plan for him.
Yes.
And I'm here to tell you tonight that if there's a plan for me, there's a plan for each and every single one of you. We're gathering tonight on Super Bowl weekend. And after Sunday, every NFL team goes into what is called an off-season, where they reflect on the things that they do well, the things that they didn't do well. They identify their strengths, they identify their weaknesses, and then something occurs in March and April called a draft, where every college player that wants to enter the league enters the draft, and teams devise what's called a draft strategy in order to pick the right players to help their team improve in the next year. I was having sort of a spiritual off-season, if you will, a few months back. And I was reflecting on everything that I went through in 2016, the challenges that I faced, the trials that I went through. And I was asking God, what do I need for 2017? What do I need for the upcoming year? How can I improve in my walk with you? And God brought an answer to my heart that I wasn't expecting. He brought a verse in 1 Samuel chapter 15. And I heard the Holy Spirit say to me, what is more pleasing to the Lord? Your burnt offerings and sacrifices, or your obedience to His voice? Behold, obedience is better than sacrifice. Now I want you all to remember that. You see, God was showing me a way that I can go deeper with Him. You see, I had the sacrifice part now. I went to church, I preach the word, I lead worship, I go to Bible study, I lead Bible study. But often I've ignored His voice. There have been times in my life where I'd be talking to somebody and I'd hear the small, still voice of the Holy Spirit saying, I want you to pray for that man, and I wouldn't do it.
Right.
There would be times in my life where I would hear the Lord tell me, I want you to tell that man that I love him, and I didn't do it. So the theme that I want to talk to you about tonight is committing to obedience.
Amen.
Can we pray? Father, may the words of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Tonight, I want to look briefly at a couple of highlights from the story of Noah. And I chose Noah because Noah obeyed God. And Noah's obedience changed the course of human history forever. Noah was a man that said yes to God when the entire world said no to God. And I'm excited to give this to you tonight because I believe it's going to give us some key insights on how to live a life of true obedience and the blessing, the life-changing blessing that comes from it. If you have your Bibles and you want to turn with me, can we open up to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7? And then if you could put your finger in Genesis chapter 6. Amen? Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11, verse 7. And Genesis 6. We'll start with Hebrews 11, verse 7. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. It says, it was by faith Noah built a large boat to save his family from the flood. He obeyed God, who warned him about the things that never happened before. By his faith, Noah condemned the rest of the world and received the righteousness that comes by faith. So let's just stay here for 1 second. We're introduced to Noah as a man who obeyed God. And he was a man of great faith. And he was used in a mighty way by God because he demonstrated his faith by his obedience. He was what's called a hearer of the word and a doer of the word. He heard God's voice and he did what God said. Now when we flip over to Genesis chapter 6, we read the rest of the account of the famous story of Noah. Genesis chapter 6, we're going to start at verse 9. I still hear pages from that, no way. Amen? Verse 9 says, this is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, the only blameless person living on earth at the time, and he walked in close fellowship with God. He was a righteous man. He lived to please God. He was a blameless man. He had integrity among the people that he lived with. And the reason he was both righteous and blameless all had to do with his walk. It says he walked closely with God. You see, walking with God is obeying God. Obeying God is called pleasing God. Pleasing God means to make God smile. Nothing pleases God more than to see somebody obeying him and walking by faith. To see somebody making all of their daily decisions based on their relationship with God. Because in that case, God now becomes real to that person. He's not just some mystical figure that's out there that people talk about. He's not just words on a page in a Bible. All of a sudden, God is real now to the person who obeys him. But what's interesting is the context in which Noah walked with God. As we read verse 5, go back to verse 5 in Genesis chapter 6, we see the kind of world that Noah lived in. It says in verse 5, then the Lord saw the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. The Lord was sorry that he made man on earth, and he was grieved in his heart. The Lord said, I will destroy man whom I've created on the face of the land, from man to animals, to creeping things, and to birds of the sky, for I am sorry that I have made them. Translation, Noah was walking with God when the entire earth wasn't. Noah was the exception to the rule. Everybody was participating in sin, but Noah walked with God. Noah was the odd man out. Noah was the weirdo. Noah was the guy you didn't want to invite to your party. Because he didn't do what the world was telling him to do. He didn't think the way the world was telling him to think, and he didn't act the way the world was telling him to act. He wasn't trying to be popular with the world in which he lived, because the world in which he lived was not popular with God. You see, I say this to you tonight because I can appreciate that. Because there was a time in my life where I traded my righteousness with God for popularity in the world. There was a time in my life where I stopped walking with God and started walking with the crowd. But I thank God for two parents who committed to obeying His word, who prayed each and every single day. Every time I went out to the Osprey, my mother was on her knees begging the Lord to have mercy on my soul and that He would bring me to this place right now. I had a father who every time I acted out, he loved me anyway.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And I thank God that I'm standing here this day because of Jesus Christ and the obedience of my parents.
Hallelujah.
But Noah's world was wicked.
Yes, he was.
And doesn't that sound a lot like where our world today is heading?
Yes.
You see, we're living in a time of great wickedness ourselves.
Yes.
The hearts of people are growing cold each and every single day. The enemy has been working overtime, blinding the truth of God's word to many people. And here's what's worse. What's worse is the enemy is so good. Pastor Mike always says he's a waste of talent. He's so good that he is deceiving the body of Christ.
Yes, he is.
I tell you what, I can't even go on Facebook anymore. I used to like Facebook. Up until I started seeing things on there that both broke my heart and also made me mad. You see, there were Christians on there who are pointing people to their favorite political candidate, then pointing them to Jesus Christ. And I'm here to tell you right now, the enemy is alive and well. And the enemy has been working overtime specifically in the body of Christ. And here's the thing. When you're living in that kind of world, there's pressure. There's pressure as a Christian to conform. There's pressure when you're at the office. There's pressure when you're at the school. You know, I just gotta say, I feel sorry for Christians who are teaching in the school system these days. In the educational system, because the things their superiors are making them do and making them go along with, I gotta tell you, the enemy is working overtime.
Amen.
But why is it like this? Why is there so much pressure? It's very simple, saints, because you're trying to do everything God's way and the world isn't. You see, when we come in here, everybody agrees. We're all saints in here. We're all Christians. This is a safe place. And guess what? If you don't agree with what we're saying, you're going to fake it anyway. Because you're outnumbered this time. You see, that's why once we go back out into the world, though, the pressure mounts again. When we go back to our family gatherings where there are people who don't know who Jesus is, there's pressure. So when you try to be a Noah in a secular world, the more serious you are with your walk with God, the more odd you're going to look like. The more different you're going to look like. It's that simple. And it's not that you're trying to be weird. It's because you're not of this world and they are. You see, Noah walked so close to God that at the time, he was the only one that God was talking to. Hebrews 11 says he was warned of God. What did God say? God, man, I'm just going to sum this up to you in layman's terms. God said, hey, Noah, since we've been hanging out together so much, since I know you and you know me, we're cool. I'm going to let you in on a little secret. You see, when you walk closely with God, you get the special privilege of hearing Him speak. Can we say amen to that?
Amen.
That's how we know that we serve the one true living God, because when we speak to Him, He is kind enough to speak back to us. He is kind enough to tell us what His plans are.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now let's look at verse 11, moving on in the story. Now God saw that the earth had become corrupt and was filled with violence. God observed all this corruption in the world, for everyone on earth was corrupt. So God said to Noah, I have decided to destroy all the living creatures, for they have filled the earth with violence. Yes, I will wipe them out off the face of the earth. Make for yourself a large bow from cypress wood. Now we've got to stop right here for a second. Because in order to appreciate this, we need to understand how ridiculous of a request that was. God tells him, I'm going to destroy the world and I want you to make a bow. But in order to appreciate this, we got to go back to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7 real quick. You don't have to turn there. But it says, he obeyed God, now watch this now, who warned him about things that never happened before. Up until this point, it's never rained on the earth. Noah had no idea what rain was. Noah's never seen a flood before. And here's the thing, too. We read in and when you study this passage, Noah was 100 miles away from the next known body of water. Why on earth would God tell him to make this boat on dry land, 100 miles away from the next body of water? They didn't have trailers back then. It's not like you could just take in the boat, put it on the back of a trailer, drive it over there, and have himself a good time. So, this doesn't make sense. But see, when God is close enough to you to speak to you, and if what he tells you is weird, that means he's getting ready to do something big. Amen. The weirder God's instruction is, the more impact it's going to have on the world. Now remember that. Remember that. The weirder, remember that phrase. You see, God tells Noah, build a boat on dry land. You've never seen rain before. You don't know what a flood is. Oh, and by the way, I want you to trust me. I probably would have had some follow-up questions. Are you sure about this? You know, are you sure this is what you want me to do? And see, this wasn't just a little speedboat. This boat was 450 feet long. To give you an idea, it was the length of one football field and a half. 1.5 football fields long, it was 45 feet high, and now watch this. It took him 120 years to build it. Some of you are here tonight saying, I've been waiting on God a long time. And I haven't seen a drop of rain yet. Some of us in here are still waiting on God's healing. Some of us in here are still waiting on the job that God supposedly is supposed to provide to us. Some of you are waiting on the spouse that he has for you to show up. Some of you are waiting on him to break that addiction that you can't seem to break. Some of you are sitting here waiting for God to bring salvation to the person that you've been praying for. And we haven't seen a drop of rain yet. But the second you feel like giving up, remember this. God wants you to know tonight that there's rain in the forecast. There's rain in the forecast. He's not God for you. He's heard your prayers. He's not angry with you. He's going to work it all out for you. It may look bleak today, but there's rain in the forecast tomorrow.
Hallelujah.
Now when you go down to verse 22, you don't have to turn there. But I love this. Genesis chapter 6, verse 22, it says, and Noah did everything exactly as God commanded him. You see, the problem with us is that we like to do some of the things that God commands us to do. But you see, partial obedience is disobedience. God requires our complete obedience so that he can open up the floodgates of heaven and do what he wants to do. You see, a lot of times when we come across challenging scriptures, you know, scriptures that challenge our faith. I mean, I can't speak for you guys, but I know back in the day, I used to look at scriptures like that and say, that's for Pastor Mike. That's not for me. Those are for the elite. I'm just a guy just trying to hang out. I'm cool. I just want to make it to heaven. That's for Pastor Mike. But see, Jesus asks a question in Luke chapter 6, and he says plainly, why do you call me Lord, yet you don't do what I ask you to do? You see, we tend to love having a Savior, but we don't necessarily like having a Lord. Come on. I remember when I finally was coming back to Christ, I was going to church for about a year, year and a half. I was back to church. And there was a man that kept coming to Hope Community Church and preaching once a month. And every time this man would come, he would walk up to me and say, "Woo, you got a word in you, boy."